everyone, and welcome to another Animated Look Back. Looking at Mulan. Now, this is another movie that came out around the time when CGI animation was really being integrated into animated films, and it came out the same year as Bugs Life. The story is about this woman, Fa Mulan, who risked her life to save her father. Basically, the Han army is invading China, and the emperor has ordered one man from every family to join the army. And since in Mulan's family, he has no sons, her father needs to join. And seeing that her father is very sick and would not survive the fight, she takes his armor, dresses up like a man, and joins the army. She's accompanied by a small dragon named Mushu who helps her along her journey. Now let's talk animation here. The animation here is really exceptional. I mean, the effects that they have at the beginning, the watercolor effects look really nice, and they have great crowd shots of thousands of people, and they look spectacular. And then there is the battle sequence with all the Han army charging down the hill on horseback. That scene is animated so well. I love how well that is, how well and textured it is. So much so that it's in my intro. Now let's look at our characters, and I'll save Mulan for last since she is the most important character to the film. So let's start with Li Shang, voiced by B.D. Wong. Now he is the captain of the guard that is assigned with training Mulan and all the other troops. He is strict but fair. He is strong but vulnerable.
Captain Li Shang. Leader of China's finest troops. No, the greatest troops of all time.
Sometimes he falls in the rut of being a little bit of a cliche. However, this character of a strong, honorable man isn't one that we see that often in the movie. It is usually this, either the scoundrel or the underdog that is the male lead in one of these films. So it's a welcome change to see this type of a character. A character who is strong and won't back down from anyone. Now, Mushu, voiced by the sometimes funny, most of the time not, Eddie Murphy, is a dragon that works for Mulan's ancestors, who decide to send a guardian to bring Mulan back. Mushu says, I can do it, and they say, no, you have failed being a guardian before, where you're not doing, all you do now is ring the gong. So, go wake up the great stone dragon. So they send Mushu to do that, but accidentally, Mushu accidentally destroys the stone dragon, which, just a side note, if the stone dragon was actually a real guardian, does that mean Mushu killed him? Something to think about. Anyway, after doing that, he realizes the only way the ancestors would ever take him back is if he made Mulan a war hero. So he goes to help Mulan.
It's going to take a miracle to get me into the army.
Did I hear someone ask for a miracle? Let me hear you say, ow!
Ah!
That's close enough!
A ghost!
Get ready, Mulan! Your 17th salvation is at hand! For I have been sent by your ancestors to guide you through your masquerade!
Come on, if you're going to stay, you're going to work.
So heed my word! Because if the army finds out you're a god, the penalty is death!
Who are you?
Who am I? Who am I? I am the guardian of lost souls. I am the powerful, the pleasurable, the indestructible Mushu.
Oh, pretty high, huh?
Now, like the gargoyles on Hunchback of Notre Dame, this is another one of those supernatural elements that they put in the film to add humor and mystery. However, it is much more well-integrated here for two reasons. Unlike Hunchback and Pocahontas, it feels natural to fit into the story, where the other films, the supernatural element felt like it was there for no reason. Also, the second thing is that Eddie Murphy is actually funny.
No!
Yeah, I know it's kind of hard to believe, but he's actually a fun and entertaining character, and you find him to be a likable character throughout the film.
Listen, I need firepower.
Who are you?
Your worst nightmare.
He's entertaining to watch, and he has great dialogue with his sidekick, Cricket. Who's a cricket? The only problem that I really have with this character is that the only reason he wants to help Mulan is so he can help himself. He even says it, the only reason he really helps her is for selfish reasons. Which would have been okay if they had something where, you know, maybe he learned that doing stuff for yourself isn't as honorable or rewarding as doing things for others without a reward. I don't know, I would have been liked if they had something, but the way it stands, it's not that big of a deal.
You missed! How could you miss? It was 3 feet in front of you!
But at least he isn't a total a-hole about it, unlike the sequel. But I'm not going to talk about that. Now, the villain of this film is the leader of the Hun army named Shang Yu. Now, I love this guy. I mean, even though he's not that much of an in-depth villain, I just love him. He's a total brute through and through. And I don't know, because he's the leader of a giant army, and the only reason he really invades China is because they made the Great Wall, and he considered that as a challenge to his might. So that's why he's invading China.
The Emperor will stop you.
Stop me? He invited me. By building his wall, he challenged my strength. Well, I'm here to play his game. Go! Tell your emperor to send his strongest armies. I'm ready. How many men does it take to deliver a message?
One.
I don't know. The only thing is, as I said, you don't get a... He's not really in... But I just love the way this guy's voice sounds. The voice actor, Miguel Ferrer, something like that, his voice is really deep and really evil, is menacing, and the lines that he doesn't give a lot of lines, but when he does, they're really evil, and you're like, oh yeah, that's good. He just has that menacing voice that you love to hear, and as he reads his lines, you just can't help but smile. His lines are not big ones, but he sells it with his voice. Soldiers, Lin, Chin Po, and Yao, well, they're cliches. They are cliches. There's the one that's Lin, the skinny male wisecracking character, Chin-Po, the big, gigantic, pacific guy who doesn't really want to fight, but he could, you know, knock anybody out with one punch if he wanted to. Then you have the really short guy, Yao, who, the best way to describe him is a Chinese Yosemite Sam.
Look, this tattoo will protect me from harm.
I hope you can get your money back.
First, I don't know why, but I just love Yao. I don't know. Maybe it's just the voice actor. It's just, I don't know. It's just the lines that he says always make me laugh.
Let them slip through my fingers.
Now, since they are secondary characters, it's not that big of a deal that they're cliches. It's okay if they're a little bit of a cliche as long as they serve their purpose and keep the story entertaining, which for the most part they do. Now I just want to quickly talk about Mulan's family. One, her mother. She doesn't talk that much and doesn't voice her opinion, probably voicing how women of that time did. Act. Two, Mulan's father. He's a stern, honorable man who sticks to his principles. And you can see that he has an honorable spirit and that Mulan got that from him, probably instead of her mother. Three, the grandma. She cracks me up. I love this character. She's just, every time she says something, I just have to laugh.
Great. She brings home a sword. If you ask me, she should have brought home a man.
Excuse me. Does Fa Mulan live here? Thank you.
Woo! Sign me up for the next war.
Now we come to Mulan. Now this, of course, since being the main character, is the most important, because if we don't buy her journey and don't buy what she goes through, then it doesn't matter what the rest of the characters do, it just isn't going to be worth it. In this movie, she starts out by trying to impress a matchmaker so she can bring honor to her family. I find it interesting how, in the way they talk to her, getting her prepared for it in the song, and the way that they respond to her is kind of subtle, but they're basically saying that in order to become the perfect bride for the matchmaker, you have to forego anything that makes you who you are and be this. And you can tell that that's not the message they're trying to get across, but that is the message they're getting across. However, of course, she blows it by a couple of weird and kind of funny events. And the matchmaker tells her that she will never bring her family on. This leaves Mulan feeling empty. And she looks into a pool of water and she talks about how she doesn't know who she is anymore. What's her purpose? What is her place in this world? Is she really something worthwhile? Or is she just something that doesn't really need to exist in the world? The themes of this film is finding out who you are and bringing your family on. She says that when she looks herself in a pond and sees her reflection, that she doesn't really know who she is, or what she is even there for. And she says that when she sees herself, she sees nothing. When her father is ordered to go to war, and she protests her opinions and that he shouldn't have to go, he responds by telling her,
I know my place. It is time you learned yours.
She takes his advice, but not in the way that he would have wanted. Of course, she steals his armor and poses as a soldier. Well, and she says it so she can, if she can do this, that maybe she could look in the mirror and see if she could find something worthwhile. Something about her that was worth being. A reason that she would want to be herself. She is made an instantly sympathetic character by risking her life to save her father's. And it is a far different cry from what Disney women characters normally are. Of course, normally they are characters that want to go out in the world and explore and do adventurous things. But for Mulan, it's more, her reasons are selfless. They are less selfish as the other ones, because those ones are all thinking about me, I want to do this. She's thinking about, I'm going to do this so I can save my father's life. And she's made a more likable character because of that. As the film goes on, and she learns to overcome the obstacles that plague her, and how she learns to be a soldier, and she overcomes the things that she never thought she could do, she becomes more of an independent character. In the first one, you can see she's full of self-doubt, doubting herself, thinking that she can't do anything. And slowly, even before she realizes it, she becomes an independent woman, an independent character. She can go into war, she can fight, she can make decisions in the battlefield.
It looks like you're out of ideas.
Not quite.
Near the end of the film, she goes to her father with the crest of the Emperor and the sword of Shan Yu, and basically to say, look, I could do something that was worth honor. And he basically throws him aside. He doesn't care, and he says, the greatest honor that I could have is having you for a daughter. And that, I think, really ties up the whole message of the film about obtaining honor and being yourself. It's all about, instead of looking for something of honor, it's all about being something that is worth honor. You don't need to do anything to get honor. Having honor is who you are. And I think that is an all-around good message for the audience.
Now it's time for a second opinion.
Hello. So, what do I think of Mulan? Well, oh, by the way, I am Kenneth's sister. And he asked me to do a review. So, I will tell you quickly. I think it's the villain in this show is one of the best villains ever. I mean, that's why they never really made any villain songs. Like, the Disney shows usually have a villain song. He didn't have one. He didn't need one. He was just too bad scary without needing a song. Like, he cut a treetop in half with his sword. I mean, and it just seemed like he knew where the enemy was. Anyway, I love the animation. That scene where his whole army is coming down the mountainside, that's great. I love the whole story of a woman pretending to be a man and the man being too dumb to realize she's a woman. I mean, that's just a classic story. I mean, really, she's a woman, guys. Get the picture? And then, you know, and I like the fact that, you know, in that culture, women, their value wasn't very, you know, they didn't have a voice, and she made a voice for herself. She basically saved China. She saved. And I love all the characters. There's no really weak character in the whole movie of Mulan. There's the dragon's hilarious. Like, all the characters are great. So it's a really, really great story. That's basically all I have to say. Except my favorite song is "Let's Get Down to Business." Great song. Okay.
It's all Mega Man.
Oh yeah. It's all Mega Man with you. Sorry. That line, "Let's Get Down to Business," is in the song. Okay. I will stop now. It's a great movie. I give it 10 stars out of 10. See you.
Now, having said that, there are some things in this movie that I am really annoyed by. First big thing, the ancestors. Okay, I find them, even though I'm not Chinese, I find them offensive to Chinese people, don't you?
As a man, you're all way past the beauty sleep thing, trust me.
I knew it! That Mulan was a troublemaker from the start!
Don't look at me! She gets it from your side of the family!
She's just trying to help her father!
But if she's discovered, Bajou will be forever shamed. Dishonor will come to the family. Traditional values will disintegrate!
Not to mention, they'll lose the farm.
I mean, in the first scene, they're always bickering and saying, do Chinese people believe, like, I know probably most people don't believe that that's how their ancestors work or whatever, but do they think that Chinese people at the time really saw their ancestors work that way? Or, or like in the ending part of the movie, they're having a party and there's music going on. I don't know. It's just, I found it kind of disrespectful. You know, I don't know. But I just don't see how a Chinese person could watch that and not be even a little bit offended. Some of the scenes just don't make sense. When they're walking off the battle, you can see that there's like 50, 100 something soldiers, right? There's tons. And then when the battle actually starts, there's only about like 10 of them. Where did the other ones go? I think the reason they lowered it is because there's that avalanche scene and all the soldiers huddle around that cliff to survive the avalanche. But still, that is sloppy! All these soldiers walk in and then there's only like, what, 10? That's just sloppy. But some of the jokes do fall flat.
Now that's what I call Mongolian barbecue.
I don't get it. Also, I kind of didn't like that the villain who was treated so seriously throughout the film died in such a cartoonish way. I mean, he was defeated... I don't know, this just seems like a Wile E. Coyote thing. You know, I just think you could have had a more fitting end. And speaking of ends, I want to talk about the last scene. Like, you know, I'm not going to show it yet because, in case you haven't noticed, when I end my animated lookbacks, I show the very last scene of the movie. Usually hoping there's the end on it to show the end of the review, but so far there's only been one. But anyway, my point is, you'll see the last scene does not tie up the movie at all. And it's just the wrong way to end this movie. And I mean, the entire way you handle it and then you end it that way, that's not the right way to end this movie. For the songs, I think that even though they're not all good, they all have a certain place. I mean, like, you can tell so many things during a song that you can't tell normally. You can tell something through the lyrics of the song and showing something while the song's going at the same time. And the songs all have a certain place. Like the beginning song, when they're talking how they're gonna make her the perfect bride, there's some scenes where she starts acting the way she acts, and you see the contrast between what they want her to be and who she really is. So, you know, all of the songs have a purpose, even if they're not that good. There are some good songs. The only songs that I really like are A Girl Worth Fighting For, and I'll Make a Man of You. Both of those are really nice songs, and they're funny, and they just have an extremely nice tone to them. I like the way the song goes.
I'm a girl back home who's unlike any other.
Yeah, the only girl who'd love him is his mother.
So overall, I think that Mulan is a pretty well overall film. It does have the normal Disney stuff that they cram in there, except it is integrated much more into the story better than other films. The tone of the movie can be serious, but it can be lighthearted. It's not too much of both. It has the right mixture. And it tells an overall entertaining and well-done story. So I think Mulan can get nothing less than a 7.5 out of 10. Thanks for watching. Remember, I'm LazyD99. If I don't like it, it's not worth it. Oh. Watch this coming up scene of the ending of Mulan and tell me, is this the right tone to end the movie on? Thanks.
You know, she gets it from my side of the family.
Thanks, Mushu.
Mushu! Whenever you feel your world is...
sure to check out more of my other videos on my channel. And wait for more coming soon.